What's up, guys? Welcome back to the channel. Today I'm going to show you how to install Arch Linux, and I'm also going to show you how to set up Hyprland, a tiling Windows manager that I think is pretty neat, and I'm going to share my config with you. All right, let's get into it. I'm Saul. Let's do tech. All right, so the very first thing we want to do is download the latest ISO. So we'll open up our browser and head on over to archlinux.org. Once the site loads, we'll head on over to the download section and we scroll down to find our nearest mirror where we can download from. There's plenty of mirrors all around the globe. So I'm going to pick one that's near me and I'm going to grab the ISO right over here. This next step is optional, but it's always nice to know how to do. I'm going to show you how to verify the checksum of the file. Here we have the hash for the file. And if we open up our terminal, here we go. Now we head on over to the download section where our ISO is. And Windows has this little tool called certutil. So we'll type that in. And we'll give the parameter of a hash file. And in here, we'll get the name of the ISO. Here it is. And now we need to give it the type of checksum. So it's going to be the SHA-256. And here we go. So now it calculates the checksum. And here's the hash. And we can compare to see if it is indeed matching what we expected to have from the site. And sure enough, it matches. And now we're going to download Rufus. So we'll open up our browser and type Rufus into Google. And Rufus is a tool that lets us create bootable USB drives from an ISO. So here's the site. We'll scroll down and here is the download link. So we'll click on that. All right, let's go ahead and plug in an empty USB drive. And let's open up our file explorer and go to our download folder. And here we have the two files, so we'll open up Rufus. First thing we want to do is make sure that we are on select, and we are. And let's hit select, and now let's pick the ISO. And at this point, we are ready to go, so we'll click start. We'll tell it to write, and we'll say yes, and okay, this is actually a confirmation that it will delete everything off the drive, so make sure that was empty and you didn't need anything off of it. With that complete, we're ready to close the program. And at this point, we can actually shut down our computer because we're getting ready to install Arch Linux. All right, at this point, it's important to know that we are going to be installing a brand new operating system onto the computer. This means that your current drive will have all data deleted off of it. So please make sure you back it up. Actually, I recommend that you get a separate drive for your Linux installation and keep your Windows drive untouched. So I'm going to use this 2 terabyte drive right here to install Linux on and use that for my Linux install and keep my Windows drive separated. Now with the USB drive plugged in, turn on your computer holding the escape key. This will give you the boot menu and you can go ahead and pick the USB drive to boot from and you'll get the Arch Linux installer booting up. And now that we're at the prompt, we are ready to start the installation. First step is to get the laptop connected to the internet. So we'll use the iwctl command. This allows us to connect the Wi-Fi. So we'll use the command station and then WLAN 0 and show. This will show us what we're doing with the Wi-Fi commands. So right now we're not scanning, so we'll do up key and we'll change show to scan. And here we go, we're scanning now. And now we're going to change the command to connect. And we'll start typing our SSID. In my case, it's sold as Tech Wi-Fi, and hit enter. And now we'll type in the password. And as you can see, we're connected and we're sending data. So we're good. We can quit now. And at this point, I'll clear the screen. This next step is optional, but I find it very useful when trying to install Arch is to actually update the GPG keys. So I'll go ahead and say pacman key dash dash init. And then after that, I'll go ahead and do pacman key dash dash populate and Arch Linux. And this updates all the keys. There we go. And at this point, we are ready to actually start the install. So we'll use Arch install and hit enter. And here's our installer. First thing is our language. English is fine here. Keyboard US is okay. Now I'm going to choose the mirror region. And you can scroll through here and find your region, but or you can forward slash and just start typing. So I'll pick United States. Language is fine. Coding is fine. Drives. Okay, so here we pick the drive we want to install too. Again, this will delete everything off the drive, so be careful. Make sure you pick the right drive. So here's my 2 terabyte. I'll hit space and select it. And now I have an option for disk layout. So now here we have different options that we can do. We are going to pick the wipe all. So again, it's going to delete everything. Here's our file system choice. I'm going to pick ext4. And would I like a separate partition for home? I'm going to say no to that. This encryption, I'm going to keep that off. Again, all the stuff is optional, depends on what you want to do. Bootloader, I'm going to use grub. Even though it's not the default, I'll use grub. I'll keep the swap, keep the host name same. I can always change that later. I'm not going to set a root password. And I'm going to create a user account. So let me click on that. I'm going to add user. So here's my user. And here's my complicated password. And I'm going to make sure it's a super user. I'm going to say yes. And now I'm going to confirm and exit. Now I'm going to pick a profile. So we have 4 different profiles, desktop, minimal, server, and Xorg. This is going to be a minimal install. So I'm going to go ahead and pick the minimal profile. In audio, I'm going to pick an audio server. I'm going to choose Pipwire. Kernels, I'm not going to change anything here. Additional packages, I'm going to add Git. I'm going to type that in. Here we go. And space. And I'm going to use NeoVim as well because I enjoy using that text editor. And I'm going to hit enter. It's going to verify. And sure enough, it found packages for it. So we're ready to go. Network configuration. I'm going to use Network Manager. And time zone. I'm going to click on that. Same thing as the mirror list. You can scroll through it or forward slash and then start typing in your zone. Mine is going to be the Los Angeles area. So I'm going to pick that. And on the option of repo, I'm going to pick the multi-lib library just in case. And now that I'm ready, I am going to choose the install. And the install is going to kick off. Now, this install is going to download a bunch of packages from the internet. It could take a long time. Go get yourself a cup of coffee and come back. I'm obviously going to fast forward here at this point. Feel free to pause while your machine is downloading all the packages. All right, now we're at the end and we can go ahead and unplug the USB drive and hit no on this option. And then we just type reboot. And that's going to reboot our system into Arch Linux. All right, after the system boots, we get the login screen. So we'll type in our username and password. And now we need to connect it to Wi-Fi. So we'll use the nmcli command here. And we'll use device keyword. And we'll say Wi-Fi. And then we'll say connect. And now we'll put in the SSID. In my case, it's soldustech Wi-Fi space and the keyword password. And now you have to actually type in the password for your Wi-Fi. So mine is obviously blurred out. And we'll hit enter. And we'll get a confirmation in a second here that it is connected. And sure enough, it was successful. Now Now we need to install a package manager called yay. So we'll cd into the op directory. And we'll do a sudo git clone. And we'll type in the URL, which is all going to be in the description. This is the AUR for Arch Linux. And yay-git.git. Here we go. We hit enter and it's going to ask us for our password again. So we'll type that in and it's going to download and clone the repo. Now, if we do an ls, we can see that this is owned by root. We need to change the owner to be our user. So in my case, it'll be sol:sol. And now we can see that sol owns that directory. We can cd into it. And we'll do a make package dash si and hit enter. It's going to want to download go. We'll say yes to that. And here we go. Yay is installed. Now we'll type in yay dash s u y to update it. And it's going to connect and everything is ready. And now we are ready to download my project, which has all the config files in it, as well as a setup script. So let's head on over to opt and we'll do a sudo git clone. And my project is on GitHub. So we'll put in the URL, github.com/soldoestech/hyprland.git. We'll hit enter. And it's going to clone it to the local location. Here we go. Now, again, this folder is owned by root. So we'll do a sudo chown dash r, so it's recursive. And we'll say sol:sol. Hyprland for you will be your username. Obviously, for me, it's sol. And now we can cd into Hyprland. And we'll look at the directory structure. So here's all the configs. And the set hyper script is the one that we want. So we'll change that to an executable. Here we go. And now we'll go ahead and run it. So the first thing it will ask me if I want to disable the Wi-Fi power save. I'm going to say yes to that. That's going to make my Wi-Fi connection more stable. Took care of that for me. The next thing is, do I want to install the packages? Well, of course. So yes. And it's going to go through and it's going to reach out and download everything that we need for Hyprland. All right, when it's done, it's going to ask me if I want to copy the config files. I'm going to say yes, because I would like all the config files to be copied. It's going to ask me if I want to install the Starship shell. In my case, I do. So I'm going to say yes. And it's going to say, do I want to install the Asus ROG software? Because I have an Asus ROG laptop, I'm going to say yes to that. All right, now we got all the software that we need. And it's asking me if I want to go ahead and start Hyprland now. I'm going to say yes. Let's go ahead and start. And here we are. We have a fully working Hyprland installation and it's fully configured and ready to go. All right, so let's get familiarized with the system. On the very top, it's called waybar. We have a microphone volume. So we have mute and unmute when you click on it. Same thing for the speakers. When you click on it, you can mute it. Another click, it's unmute. You can use your mouse scroll wheel to increase and decrease the volume. We have a monitor brightness control over here, which is not going to work because I have an output to an HDMI. And we have our battery. We also have, because we installed the Asus ROG software, a way to switch our power profiles. So we have one click for performance, another click for quiet, and another click for balance. Next thing, we have our temperature, and if we mouse over, we can see it in Celsius. We have our Bluetooth. It shows me that it's on. And I also have my Wi-Fi connection. It shows me the Wi-Fi strength, as well as additional information about my Wi-Fi network. In the center here, right now, we don't have anything open, but this is where the title bar is going to be for each application that we launch. We also have our workspaces here. There can be up to 10 workspaces. And we also have our temperature, local temperature. It's nice and sunny, 69 degrees, not bad. And we have our clock and calendar. If we mouse over, we actually get a month view for the calendar. All right, so now let's dig in a little bit deeper and see exactly what we got here. If we hit the window key and Q together, we'll get a terminal. And now we can cd into our home directory and then cd into the .config directory. Here's all the folders with the configuration files for everything that we installed. And the one we want to look at right now is the Hypr directory. And inside there, we can take a look. We have our background image. We have our configuration. We also have an executable in there for the portal. Let's take a look at the config. So we'll open that up. First thing that we see is the monitor. So right now it's set up for the preferred auto, but I've also left the config in there for if you want to do dual monitors or if you want to get an idea on how to set up your monitor in different resolutions and different refresh rates. So the DP will be the external monitor, the EDP is your internal monitor. Over here, we're executing some stuff. This is where we're starting our waybar and where we're setting up our background image. We scroll down, we have some additional options. Everything is documented in the wiki. I left links for the wiki in the config file if you want to go and look and see exactly how to tweak and customize your installation and make it more unique to you. Here we have the various animations that are set up right now. And our different gestures. And over here, we can set up some Windows rule. So this will allow us to make some of these windows a little bit more see-through. So over here, you can see that I have Kitty, which is our terminal, set up with an opacity of 0.8. And that's how you're able to see through it. And here we have our key binding. This is how we tell Hyprland which application to launch. So the first one we already know, it's Windows Q to launch Kitty. Next one is Windows Shift X, that will kill an active window. The one after that is Windows L, which will lock your screen. So I'll go ahead and demonstrate that right now. Here we go. And to get out of this, you can just type in the password and hit enter. So I'll try that right now. And here we go. It also will capture if somebody actually typed in the wrong password. So let me show you that. And now when I start typing my password again, I'll see the number one there, which tells me that it was one bad attempt. The next one is Windows key M, and that will let you do the logout screen, which there are various things here. You can reboot, you can shut down, you can log out, you can also lock the screen. The one after that is Windows Shift M. This is a forced exit of Hyprland. The one after that is going to be the Shift E, which is a graphical file browser named Thunar. So let me launch that. Here we go. So this allows us to browse our file system. Let me go ahead and close that. There we go. All right. The next one is Windows V. This allows us to actually toggle the window from being tiled to floating. So let me demonstrate. I'm going to hit the Windows V key right now. And as you can see, I can make this window smaller and I can grab it and move it around. Now, this is not a full-blown Windows environment, right? So let me launch another window right now. There we go. And then I'll make that float as well. And I'll make it a little bit smaller. Here we go. And I'll move it around. And as you can see, it's not exactly a great experience with multiple windows. When they're not tiled, but it's still doable. So let me close it. And then if I hit Windows V again, it will put it back into tile mode. Here we go. And then the next one is Windows Space, and that launches the graphical launcher. So all the applications that I'm going to install are going to show up in here, and then I can just pick them from a menu and click on them and run them. And there's a few other options here. Again, this is all customizable. You can definitely change those. If you don't like the key binding and you want to make your own, you can definitely do that. This Windows S key is for taking a screenshot, and very self-explanatory right there. Now, if you do have an Asus laptop, then there's some key binding already set up for your Asus laptop. This particular one is for the ROG G15 that I have. And this key binding right here will actually launch the ROG control panel, which is an excellent utility. It'll allow you to control your fans curves, as well as control your keyboard lighting. So I'm going to change this here to a little purple light that kind of goes with this theme. And I'll update my battery here to stop charging at 80% since I have my computer plugged in most of the day. And there's various other key binding in here. I also have the volume already set up. I have key binding for switching the fan curves, which is going to be the different power modes right over here. For brightness as well, for the screen brightness, as well as for the keyboard brightness. So that is already set up. And next are the default key binding for various movements within Hyprland, switching between windows, moving windows to different workspaces. This is very straightforward. If you look at the config, very easy to understand. Next, what I would like to do is I'd like to get this program and any other program that I've installed to actually follow the theme that I have here already set up. So this is an XFCE program. So I'll go ahead and load the XFCE appearance settings utility. And I'll pick the Dracula theme, which kind of fits this whole look. And I'll go to icons and I'll do the same thing with the icons. Here we go. So now we're looking pretty good. I'm also want to make sure that my GTK themes are set. So I'll open up LX appearance and I'll do the same thing here. So I'll switch to Dracula and same thing for the icons. All right. Now everything looks the way I would like it to look. All right, at this point, I want to install a browser. My browser, I'm going to choose Chromium. You can choose any browser you like. So I'll go ahead and use yay-s and Chromium. I'm going to put in my password. And it's going to go ahead and install all the packages needed for Chromium. All right, let me close the terminal. And now with Chromium installed, I'll just do Windows space to open up my graphical launcher, wofi, and then I'll scroll down and look for Chromium. There it is. And then I'll go ahead and hit enter and Chromium launches. I'm going to go ahead and switch the theme. So I'll click on the side here and go to settings. And then click on appearance. And I'll tell it to use the GTK theme. Here we go. Then one more thing we need to do here is because we're running on Wayland, we need to go to Chrome, :// flags, hit enter. And in the search bar, let's type Wayland. And we'll switch the first one to enable for Pipewire. And the second one down there, we'll make sure it says Wayland, and then we'll say relaunch. And now we're looking good. Now I would like to make this window see-through. So I'll open up my terminal again. So Windows Q, and I'll cd into the config folder and the Hypr folder, and I'll edit my hypr.conf. And I'll scroll down and find my Windows rule down below. Here they are. And I'll uncomment the window rule for Chromium. What's nice is that once I do that and I save this file, I don't have to restart Hyprland. It automatically reloads. So now if I'll go ahead and launch Chromium again, as you can see, it is see-through. All right, on this last section, I want to talk about logging out and logging back in, since this is not a full-blown desktop environment. It's important to understand how to do this. So I'll go ahead and hit Windows M and choose the logout. And that puts me back on to the command prompt. So if I type in my username and password, I get a command prompt. So now I just type Hyprland with a capital H, hit enter, and I'll be back into Hyprland. Thank you for watching the video, guys. I hope you enjoyed it. If you liked the video, please hit that like button. Please also consider subscribing to the channel, and thank you to everyone that already has. If you have any questions, please hit me up in the comment section. I do my best to answer all questions in a timely fashion. Thanks again, guys. I'm Saul, wishing you a nice rest of your day.